Harry, what is that contraption?
Hana, this is a key, sometimes called a bug, and it's the tool whereby wireless operators sent messages through the air as if by magic many years ago. This particular piece of equipment conjures up all kinds of memories for me. When I was a little boy, my father was a wireless operator.
Really?
Yes, and I would go visit him at Cabot Tower, which is on Signal Hill in St. John's, and I'd see him communicating with miles away. Way back in 1896, Marconi transmitted the first message in Morse code.
And then went on to discover the radio.
No, he didn't. I thought so, too. But according to Canadian hero promoter Ray Ireland, it all happened in December the 23rd, 1900, when a Canadian, Reginald Fessenden, sang hymns and said the first words in a radio broadcast. Who was Reginald Fessenden?
Reginald Fessenden was the inventor of radio. It wasn't Marconi, as most people believe.
Well, now, you know, the whole world's been going on since 1901, knowing that he did the National from Signal Hill in St. John's, and they listened to him over in Ireland.
Right, right.
I mean, everybody knows that.
That's right.
You come up with a story about Reginald Fessenden and say that Canada did it.
Right, right. Well, it just hasn't been promoted. Marconi was the man, Harry, who put code through the air, like the dots and dashes in 1896. But Reginald Fessenden, a Canadian from Quebec, was the one who actually invented radio, put the sound of the human voice, transmitted the sound of the human voice through the airwaves without the use of wires.
Did he invent the radio itself, or just the microphone, perhaps?
To the best of my knowledge, Harry, he actually invented the radio. Would you like me just to briefly tell this story?
Please do, yes.
As I said a moment ago, he was born in Quebec, schooled in Ontario. He went to Bermuda. He married in Bermuda, went to the States. He worked initially for Thomas Edison, and he only worked there 2 years because Thomas Edison was going bankrupt at that time, believe it or not. And then he worked for George Westinghouse on lamp design. He taught electrical engineering at two universities in the States. One was Purdue, I believe. But all through this period, Harry, through his 20s and his early 30s, his main goal was to invent radio. This was on his mind. He'd been an inventor since age 10. He was tinkering since he was just a kid, and this was on his mind all this time.
See, the word radio itself sounds Italian, which gives the Marconi story that much more credibility, if you like.
Yes, I suppose. I never thought of it that way, but that's the point.
Where was Fessenden educated?
He was educated at school in Ontario. Now, to be honest about it, there are conflicting reports on this. I know that some of his relatives come from the Fergus area, and I'm not sure whether he got a lot of his education there. He got part of his education in Quebec, some in southern Ontario. And then he, at age 20, he was ready to move on. And so he, as I say, in his 20s and his early 30s, he was working on this. And in 1896, depression came over him when he learned that Marconi had come up with the code through the airwaves without the use of wires. So what happened, Harry, was this. He came back home to Canada on a little trip, a little vacation in the late 1890s. And I believe this was in Fergus, Ontario. He came home he went for a walk with one of his relatives or one of his friends down by a stream, and they started skipping rocks across the water. And he turned to his friend or his relative and said, "That's it. That's radio." And his friend said, or relative said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Continuous waves. That's radio." As the waves came out from the rocks that had been skipped across the water, the waves came out. I'm not an engineer, and I don't know all the workings of engineering, but he did take this idea, this principle, and he headed back to the States. And in 1900, on December the 23rd, 2 days before Christmas in 1900, he put on his first broadcast. It was a broadcast to two towers near Washington.
Why Washington?
Well, Harry, I don't know exactly, but I believe that there wasn't interest in Canada at that time. And I must say that I don't know how you feel about it, but I do know that we seem to have a reticence, a reluctance in our nation to say we have great people, we have great actors, great inventors. And it seems that the Americans just capitalize, if they may use that word, on.
But this wasn't an American Marconi, it was an Italian.
Yes, that's true. But I'm saying in a lot of cases, Harry, that we have lost out on our people.
You know, Do you remember right after the war, for the years from 1945 to, say, 1955, 1960?
Right.
Every day you pick up the paper to find out that ice hockey was invented in the Soviet Union.
Right.
That the bicycle was invented in the Soviet Union. Right. The automobile was invented there.
Right.
The gramophone and so on. Are we not trying to do the same thing now?
I don't think so, Harry. I think that we've been sort of like a sleeping giant in a way. I think when our centennial came along in 1967, I think there was a great surge of national pride.
Yeah.
And I think that when that came out, and my wife and I were privileged to be on the Hill in Ottawa when that happened, that momentous day, and the tears were running down my cheeks, frankly, when that happened. And I was over in Queen's Park when they put up our flag for the first time. And ever since that time, I think there's been that surge of national pride. And I don't think that we're trying to capitalize or do anything devious in the land. It's just that we have had great people. We've had great people, and inventors and sports people, actors and everything else. And it's time that our nation really brought these people forward. So I think that's what that's happening. And I've kind of taken it as sort of a mission. And I know we've had some great people doing this, like John Fisher and Pierre Burton. Many people, not many, but several have done this. And I'm just getting into it, too, but maybe in a little different way. I only concentrate on the heroes and the heroines. But I don't think we're trying to do anything untoward. I think that it's really important that we do this for our country.
Well, maybe we should conclude our little chat and look forward to your next visit with us, Ray, by saying this, that radio that young man is working on might be fine for him, but it'll never catch on. Do you think it'll ever catch on? I mean, television will never catch on. If you don't believe me, ask Earl Cameron.
Incidentally, Fessenden wound up with a lot of money. He took people to court in the States. They were monopolizing on his invention. He came out. He was one inventor who wound up with a pile of money.
He did make some money on it.
A lot of money. He took people to court and came through with, I think, a couple of $1 million.
I'll tell you. It makes you proud to be a Canadian. Ray, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Harry. Pleasure to be here.